Hello, my name is Maciej Misztal. I'm the director of Lublin Film Festival, and today I'm talking with Benjamin de Buzere, the director of Some Things Are Hard to Say. So nice to see you, Benjamin.
Likewise, nice to see you too.
We know each other because we met 2 years ago, I think, at Lublin Film Festival, when you were showing your previous movie, of not such great importance.
Right, yes. It was a very nice time.
And Benjamin won an award at our film festival, Krzysztof Schott Award. So today we are talking about his new movie. So I'm very excited and it is really great to talk to you. So Benjamin, it's the second part of your trilogy, I think. In your plans, we will see three films about what? About the subject of your trilogy?
Well, to be honest, like when I was planning the third part, we got into a lockdown and I just planned a festival trip combined with my research for the third part. And then it was lockdown. And then during the lockdown, I rewrote the project and it became something else. And I ended up writing a middle-length film that didn't have to do anything anymore with these two short films. And then I just shot actually a couple of weeks ago. Yeah, it brought me somewhere else. And now when I look back on these two films, I think they can also fit nicely together just as a pair of films.
Okay, so we won't see a third part of your trilogy. It won't be a trilogy, but maybe, who knows?
You never know.
Anything happened. Yeah, you never know. Okay, so I think it's important to say about your first movie of this duology. That was about Davide. He was working as in Berlin. And in this film, we can meet also Basti, who is a main protagonist of your movie, Some Things Are Hard to Say. So they are strictly connected, I think. Is it because, as I understand, it is like 2 years past and now we can meet Basti, yes? And why did you decide to make a movie about Basti this time?
I think it happened very quickly. So this first film was about like searching, finding your ways, dealing with the choices in life. And the idea, I then already had this idea, okay, I want to have different parts and then put together, make something longer. And that I would be led also by the film itself, that it would bring me to the next part. So I didn't have this decision in advance of this is gonna be the second and this is the third. But the idea was that I would go on this search that would lead me somewhere. And very quickly in working together with Basti, it was such a special experience because Basti, he has a form of schizophrenia. So he's very different, I would say, than the usual actor you work with. So it excited me to try and write a project that was written on him, to work with him in the knowledge that I knew what are his capabilities, what are his talents, but also what are the things that he's not capable of or that make it more difficult. And just this in itself already excited me to do this film. So after this experience with him in the first film where he played this side role, I knew that I just wanted to do a film that was only about him.
And tell us more about your idea of making a movie with Basti, because Basti is not an actor, but your movie is not a documentary. It's like some kind of experiment. So what is your idea?
Yeah, I don't distinguish between documentary and fiction very much. I just call it fiction. And I just think I want to tell the story in the best way possible. And then I don't really pay attention to, is this now from reality or is it not? And I think if I would just film a figure like Basti, yeah, you would never really get the experience of how he is as a person and how I know him by knowing him now for a couple of years. because he's not a very accessible personality. So I found it more interesting to take that knowledge that I have of knowing him for many years now and being friends and try to condense his personality in a short 10-minute film. And then working with fiction, it gives you more liberty there for him to recreate the scenes. But a lot of all of the film is, of course, also really Basti. It's really him. He also has this, because of his condition, he can easily lose the sense of reality. So he can also forget just in a second again that he's acting in a film. So I keep telling him, you're acting in a film and now this is the scene. He starts the scene and then he forgets about the film and then suddenly he gets into the reality of the story. So in that sense, it's also very documentary-like because everything that he brings has such a strong authenticity in it that it feels like you're watching a documentary, I think.
It was scripted.
Yes. Yeah, well, it's also because I know him quite well after this first project and then I kept a relation with him. So I also know how he will react in a certain situation. So I can write a script where I know more or less, okay, this is gonna be the situation, this is the how we're gonna set it up. And then within these boundaries, he will play, and often I know that a certain reaction will come if I approach him in that way or ask him this. Sometimes I don't know at all, and then it's a surprise, but of course that's a nice thing about it.
And what about his relationship with Davide? This real relationship, not in a movie.
Actually, the story is written on not only his relation with Davide, but also his relation with me. So I think it's also trying to bring across this this feeling of friendship, and then I think the friendship from his perspective. But Davide did actually move back to Italy, so was far away, but Basti was not especially searching for him, or that is a fictional element I put in there. But it is a general experience I have. I don't live in my home country, I live in Berlin, and very often you make friends there, but it's sort of a passage city and people disappear again. And so very often I experience this feeling myself of missing a friend that's left again. So I just sort of projected this on him. I think a big part of what I was busy with was having him as a figure that is like very quickly defined as somebody weird, somebody out of the norm that you maybe don't want to talk to. But by knowing him, he just became sort of very normal to me. And I tried to bring in the film those elements that were very recognizable, that I recognized myself, and where I found that actually I don't differ so much.
And the rest of the actors, which that we can watch in this movie, they're also amateurs, or what is the story behind this part of your movie?
Well, like I mentioned earlier, my whole process with these films was that I would search and look at the things that come on my way and then sort of bring them into the film. So they're all people that I met in my staying in Berlin, living in Berlin, experiencing the city. So, for example, the waitress was somebody I was working with myself in a restaurant. The man at the door at the apartment building that opens was a friend of a friend that I just bumped into, and I thought, okay, you're an interesting figure, would be nice, do you want to play in the film? So it's all haphazard meetings. The dealer, the woman, I was taking pictures for the locations and I still needed to fill in that role. And she came by and asked about the pictures and about my camera, and we got to talking, and I was like, actually she seems perfect for this role. So I asked her and she said, all right, I'll do it. And yeah, often it happened like this.
So they didn't know Basti before the shooting?
No, they didn't.
And how they reacted to playing with Basti?
For example, the woman that played the dealer, I set up a meeting beforehand, so they would meet each other, and she lived a bit. Yeah, she passed away recently because of COVID. So I also dedicated the film to her. But she used to live in this squat culture in Berlin a lot. So she came more in contact with people like this, people that would be not accepted by society. So for her, it was very natural to build this relationship with him. I think the friend of a friend who played the man at the door was very surprised because I didn't set up a meeting in advance. I did tell him about Basti, but he was like, he didn't really know how to react. But then that worked well, I think, with the role he had to play. So yeah, it differed. But generally, I think the crew were the people that were in the whole 5 days that we shot together. They all developed a personal relationship with Basti, all having different ways of communicating with him. And all leaving like with a soft heart for for this man. Yes.
And do you still have contact with Basti?
When we had the shoot, he still had a cell phone, so I could call him and we could meet up. That would be possible. Like I also, in the first film, I went to always pick him up at his door because I didn't know really yet if it would be possible to set a meeting. But he lost his phone a while ago and he didn't get a new one. So now I can only meet him if I go by in the street and call at his door or walk around and see if he's there. So I did this a couple of times before I was shooting. So I still met him, but yes, his life is is very much the same and different.
Maybe we should talk more about some meaning of your movie, because we talk a lot about Basti, but I think it is not only about Basti. It's in some way universal topic. In your first movie, first from these two movies, there is a scene with Davide when he's trying to choose a pizza, and it's, you know, for me it was about some general problem of choosing a way of life. And in Some Things Are Hard to Say, there is a scene with Basti when he's trying to say the name of the dog, Dopo Domani, which means day after tomorrow in Italian. So I don't know, is it about the fear of the future or about some helplessness, you know, some things like that?
Yeah, I find it difficult to sum up a film in one term or one word, but I think, I mean, if I go back to the feeling, what I liked between them was that there was a certain contrast in Davide having all these possibilities and these choices and not being able to choose, and Basti actually like having in his head such a chaos that is general life is very much a routine and is very grounded, actually much more grounded than Davide's life. So he sort of keeps going through the same activities a bit, and he's very easily at accepting something. Like we would normally define him as this vulnerable personality, and so like would think like I really need this friend, or he would be very clingy, or he would like be afraid to lose his friends. But actually he's very, when you say I'm gone, he's like, okay, bye. And like, he's very like okay with things and stays in this routine and walks the same street every day, and the streets change, but he's not so much in for change film. So I mean, there's always several impulses that give me the idea of making it, and it's not like one definite thing that I want to tell or that I want to sum up with the film.
Yeah, sure, but yes, I'm looking for some themes of your movie. Sometimes it's so hard to think about tomorrow, to make some decisions, yes? Especially now when we are living such crazy times. For me, it's also about denying. For me, it's also some kind of universal truth that all of us sometimes deny that the truth is the truth, yeah, that he knows that Davide is no longer lives in Berlin, but he's trying to deny it. So even when he's talking with him on the phone, he still try to not accept the truth because it's not suitable for him.
It's true, yeah. It's definitely about acceptance. If you would take one word, acceptance is, I mean, therefore, some things are hard to say. Title also refers to that, yeah, some things are difficult to accept. And I think if you don't accept things, then maybe it's also more difficult to make choices.
And so, okay, tell us, if you want, what is your situation now in pandemic time? Because you are independent filmmaker. So I think it's not easy for you now to work on some new project, but we've heard that you finished some new projects. So
I shot a new film, yes. Well, like I said before, when I was writing this third part of the Before trilogy, I reorganized and was like, okay, I'm gonna spend some long time inside. I have to change my method, because my methods before for these two films was to really go into the streets or meet people, and out of these people make a film and look for things that I recognize. And then it was a sort of in the exchange with the actors, the film would come into existence. And now that was not possible. So then I focused on writing, and then I was lucky enough to get my first script writing funding, because with the previous films that I was not there yet. I mean, I got production funding for the second one, but script writing funding I discovered is the most difficult thing to achieve, because they only give it to you when they trust that that you'll make something out of it. So I managed to get my first script writing funding in September last year, and then I very quickly put up the whole project, went for development, for production. And then this September, I got production support, and I already filmed it now in October in Greece. So I think I just told myself, like, okay, I cannot keep sitting inside and doubting if I will be able to shoot something or not, or if I'll be able to go out or not. I'll just go on with the project and see if it works. And it worked.
So thank you, Benjamin, for today talking. And I hope that your next movie will be a huge success. And I hope that we will meet personally, as I said. And thank you also for your movie. Some things I had to say. And I think that after this interview, everyone should watch it, because it's very, very interesting movie.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you for the talk. And yes, again, sad that we can't meet in person, but I hope so too, that in the future it will change.
Thank you.